How do you do?
We're about to unfold the story of the Bride of Frankenstein.
She's alive! Alive!
A monster created from cadavers out of rifled graves. A tale that sent my blood into icy creeps.
Would you like to hear what happened after that?
Well, we've warned you.
You've been warned. Welcome back to Frankenstein Minute, the podcast that dissects the Universal Frankenstein films minute by minute. I'm Bill Evenson.
And I'm Thom Lang, and you join us for minute 13.
Lucky minute 13.
Lucky minute 13, recorded on the 14th. So missed it by that much. 1935's Bride of Frankenstein, released by Universal Pictures, directed by James Whale.
No kidding.
And still no shadow of the monster on the wall, as far as I can see.
Nope, there's lots of stuff on the wall.
Lots of stuff on the walls, but not shadow of the monster.
Do you want to talk about the stuff that's on the walls? Because I think it's interesting.
Yeah,
there's a display of crossed swords and antique pistols with a plaque in the middle that might have the Frankenstein family crest on it, for all I can tell, because it's not a focus, so I can't tell.
Yeah.
And then a little bit later in the minute, you can see there's even more swords mounted horizontally next to it. So a bunch of swords and pistols and shit on the wall. That's the kind of thing people did. I actually Googled that to try and figure out, is that called something? Best I can tell, no.
No.
Just
okay.
Cross swords. Like pirates
I think it's indicative that Frankenstein is a very old family.
Very violent family.
Well,
swords
evidently,
and pistols.
And, I mean, the castle has sort of a medieval quality to it at points. So, they probably at one point were used to defend the castle. There is a reference to it in the sequel to this.
I don't know what you mean.
In Son of Frankenstein, there's Atwill references.
The history of?
History of the castle a little bit. Talk about medieval days and
okay, I see what you mean. Yeah, that's right.
So I think it's fair to assume that those are all just ancestral.
The mineral baths
which appear out of nowhere.
So yeah.
So
it adds to that. It adds to that.
It gives the impression in a different way than the house in 31 that it's a very old family, very established, very well-to-do.
So we're on this topic, so I think I should mention it now.
Okay.
Because it's a hard thing to keep chronological because you see all this background stuff throughout the minute.
The whole scene.
But behind Minnie, when she screams, spoilers, she screams.
She screams.
Spoilers, Minnie screams in this one.
you don't see it coming at all.
Yeah, no. All right. Well, we'll go there. But behind there's a big stuffed bear.
Mm-hmm.
And then they cut to another angle of Elizabeth and her posse. And behind them is another stuffed bear.
It
looks like he's holding something, but...
It's hard to tell because, like you said, it's blurry in the background.
Yeah.
And there's people in between it and the foreground. So.
Right. Then there's actually
Maybe they
use
those swords or pistols to kill those bears.
It
all ties together. And those bears...
Can you imagine fighting a bear with a sword?
No.
Or two, I guess?
I can't imagine fighting a bear to begin with.
Yeah, that's probably... I think they recommend a sword, though.
Do they?
Yeah.
Definitely. You get as close in as you can.
That's right. Yeah. That's hand-to-hand combat.
Yeah, that's always your best bet.
Maybe just a buck knife. Jack knife.
Get your Bowie knife out.
Is there such a thing as a buck knife, or was I trying to say jackknife? Or a jackknife is when you turn hard to the
one way. That's a good way to kill a bear.
God, that's a good way to kill a bear. We're going bear hunting.
That's it.
Bear hunting minute. There's a bunch of people in this house. There's just tons of people.
It's the wedding day, so it's still, they're all dressed up, so it's the wedding.
There's tons of women that I think are bridesmaids.
Yes.
And then there's like one older lady. Is that Elizabeth's mother?
Well, that was a question that I had. Who is that? Because she's not prominent, but she is in a way. I mean, she's in the middle background.
Yeah, if you watch this minute, you'll get
lots of shots of her.
She's in focus,
more or less. She's less,
Out
of focus than the bear.
Than the bear. Yeah, exactly. Yep.
There were people like that, though, in the scenes towards the end of Frankenstein as well. So
it's just
a carryover. These are either family, wedding guests, her bridesmaids.
That's what I think. Especially the bridesmaids part when they cut to the group of them all together.
Yeah.
They're consoling her.
Yeah.
And then they react when, again, as we said, Minnie screams.
Yeah.
There's one woman who prominently you see her. She has this look on her face like, what?
What the hell?
She doesn't even really react. She's just told to turn, so she turns. turns and she looks more or less where she's supposed to. That's all right. I got no problem with it.
It's fine.
It's fine. So yeah, a lot of people, the help, whatever they're called, the maids or whatever, yeah, everybody's crying.
And the help, the one servants, woman's
crying so hard she's got to take her glass off use her bib or whatever to dry her eyes.
Yeah.
And very sad.
It's a sad moment. It was even sadder in the original script.
Oh, nice segue.
Yes, thank you. I mean, there's stuff prior to that, but since we're here, I believe that shot that you were talking about, the maid dabbing her eyes, and what's to come later when we find out that the Baron has died that same night.
That makes sense.
Because then the scene ends with her and Minnie standing next to each other, the exact same shot. Now Minnie has joined her.
I think you're absolutely right, because that shot.
What a terrible night.
It's specifically, what a terrible wedding night.
What a terrible wedding
night. But that shot, or that line, effectively replaces the part in the script where we learn about the death of the Baron.
Yeah.
So yeah, that makes a lot of sense.
We're jumping all around.
It's kind of jumping all over the place. There's a scene in the movie Frankenstein, 1931 film, directed by James Whale, where there's a dead man lying on a table, and the dead body's, the hand moves, and a character screams, "It's alive!"
Oh yeah,
I don't know if you remember
that. Oh yeah.
But yeah, that was kind of an iconic...
Yes.
Part of that film. Have you seen that one? You've seen it.
I've seen it.
So that happens here. That's another one of those neat little things.
Nice little callback, little throwbacks. There's a few, almost an in-joke.
Yeah.
There's a few throughout the whole film, and it's, again, Whale's sense of humor. It's having dinner with Jimmy Whale.
And that's really key to me that you say that, because if you do it in a movie now you're referencing Frankenstein, that iconic film from almost 100 years ago.
Right.
But he's doing it 4 years later.
4 years later, yeah.
So it's like it's silly. It's not silly, that's not the right word. But it's, like you say, it's part of his sense of humor.
It's a little throwaway, it's a gag.
It's more like a gag.
Because that line, we'll hear
because
it again.
Because this movie's a hoot.
It is a hoot.
Yeah.
We'll hear it again later, much later, but we've heard it already. The previous few minutes, Minnie was shrieking that it's alive as well.
Well, that's true. Good point.
So it comes up again and again, but this very much so is a throwback, because the hand moving is what indicates that this particular character is alive.
And this is something that you sort of said, when Minnie screams, she doesn't scream right away. It takes her a couple seconds, maybe two full seconds before she actually screams. And this is Minnie we're talking about, so that's
not
significant.
It's not just lit up, yeah.
Yeah, she actually sort of looks at it.
Yeah.
And I don't want another thing about it I think is interesting is, in the background, there are people coming down the stairs. Like, there's a lot.
There's a lot going on.
There seems to be a lot of activity in the background for this. And I think, I'm just going to go ahead and guess that it might have something to do with, like you say, the part about the Baron and everything being cut out.
Yeah,
Well, do people know what we're talking about?
Okay.
What happens in this? What happens in this minute, Tom?
Happens and what doesn't happen is we discover that Henry is indeed alive. He was not killed by his fall from the windmill, as is previously thought in this film.
Mm-hmm.
But while this is playing out downstairs, upstairs, and it's never really shown, there's just people coming and going from his room, indicating that Frederick Kerr, the Baron Frankenstein, has passed away.
Yeah.
Which is a very significant thing, which it's odd that it's cut out. There's a line coming up in a couple minutes that will refer to it, and that's the only really clue that you get that this has happened.
Mm-hmm.
Otherwise, it's completely eliminated. So if you're not paying attention, it just appears as a continuity error while the Baron is gone, much like Victor has completely vanished.
Oh, when you said Victor, I was thinking Victor Frankenstein.
No, Victor
But
Moritz
yeah, you're right. It's true. Victor Moritz has completely vanished.
No reference to him whatsoever, which is fine, which is actually a good thing.
I don't know, man. We got a lot of John Bowles fans that listen to this podcast.
Yeah, that's true.
Well, myself included.
They can just go straight to hell as far as this film goes.
Yeah, this is a good thing. This is part of what makes this film what it is. There's no or very little waste. It's in the scripting, the casting, and the filming and the editing.
Mm-hmm.
It's all towards a very specific goal.
Right.
And Victor has no place
in
it.
No place
in it. And that was a very deliberate decision.
Oh, I'm sure. Yeah, I'm sure Whale said, "Yeah, we don't need that. We didn't need
it." Yeah, nobody's even probably coming up to him saying, "Hey, did you notice?"
Yeah,
like there was a big subplot about how Victor wanted to fuck Elizabeth.
Yeah, yeah.
Did you forget about that? Someone might have mentioned. than that, I guess.
It's possible, and I'm just going to go out on a limb and say I would think that Whale himself said, no, we're not going to forget that he was even here.
Yeah.
It's completely unnecessary. I mean, he fulfilled the function.
In a sense, this is what we're talking about. He kind of does that with the Baron.
Yeah.
He does leave that one sentence in later, so I'm sure we'll go back to it. But it's cut out. It is in the script and cut out.
And it's dealt with very, I don't want to say perfunctorily in the script, but it is very, it's very brief. It's very quick. It's not, he doesn't get a big death scene. We don't even see him in the script, which is because Fred Kerr had passed away.
That's right.
But the earlier drafts reference seeing him from a distance and getting a double that will look enough like Frederick Kerr in wide shots and out of focus in the background to pass.
Crispin Glover. John
Livingston. They were going to get John Livingston from the end of Frankenstein to pop in. And
so you actually, now you're getting ahead of me because that's amazing that that's going to come back. This week, by the end of this episode, I will reference that again.
Okay.
So what we end up with, in my opinion, is something that's a little off-putting because everyone's crying and there's a funeral dirge playing. It's funny how often these minutes contain something that I want to call a scene. But in this case, it's almost like a scene.
It is.
Where there's a funeral dirge playing because Henry's dead and his corpse is being presented to his former bride-to-be.
Yeah.
And by the end of this minute, he's not dead, which is great.
Yeah.
That's a cool thing that everybody's super happy about. But it doesn't play out that way at all. Everyone's still crying and possibly even more so. There's lots of reasons to cry. Yeah. I cry. I'm a crier. I'll cry right now on command if you want me to.
Well,
but I'll cry at a movie. I'll cry at a well-made commercial or news story about something. And one of the reasons you might cry is just from relief, if there's a heavy, stressful situation,
and it's suddenly lifted,
as soon as it's over, as soon as I can sense it's going to be over, I can tell I'm going to cry when it ends. And that's certainly what could be happening here.
Sure.
Or just cry tears of joy. But what happens is the tears of joy argument kind of gets undercut by Minnie saying, oh, what a terrible wedding night. Because, you know, the other part of it is the assumption that everybody knows what's going on. This is something that I don't really have a handle on in this movie or in the first one either, really.
Everyone,
do people know the story of what happened?
The characters, Henry, or the audience?
The characters.
Right.
So when she says, oh, what a terrible wedding night, is she responding to a situation where Henry has miraculously survived being thrown off of a windmill? You know, that seems like a good thing.
That's a good thing.
Or in her world, were they trying to have a wedding and a fucking crazy lunatic climbed in the window and started
messing around with the whole thing?
We thought we were all going to die and now, whatever. I mean, then again, especially Minnie, because now she's the only living person that knows the monster's not dead.
Not dead, right.
I don't really have a feel for what's going on anywhere.
Well, and it's
a strength of this film, because we're moving so fast.
Right. And this will come up again in a couple weeks, that same thing, is who knows, who doesn't, who knows what exactly, how much is known of Henry's participation.
And much our current situation with coronavirus, how willing are the authorities to admit to the actual threat of the...
Well, and as we saw a few weeks ago, the authorities in this film aren't willing to admit it at all.
That's what I'm getting at.
Merely an escaped lunatic, nothing to worry about.
Nothing to worry... We've already been there, and we'll see it again.
Yeah.
Okay, so... It's confusing to me, but it's all fine, too, because, like I said, there's any number of reasons why everybody should be upset.
Well, the wedding didn't take place, so that's upsetting.
It is indeed a terrible wedding night when the wedding doesn't take
place. Wedding doesn't actually happen, yeah.
One could argue, unless the wedding itself probably shouldn't have happened in the first place, which we have no reason to think is the case.
I don't think that's the case here, yeah. But,
Although, I don't know.
Well, I mean, he did lie to her for like 4 months or whatever it was.
But you're not subscribing to my theory that this is a different Elizabeth. I should start a theory of that.
Yeah. This is the maid of honor who stepped in. Also named Elizabeth.
Oh, that would be perfect.
One went by Liz, the other went by Beth.
No, these theories are just going to get worse and worse.
Whoa, boy.
Oh, my God.
We've got a serious problem now.
Oh, my God.
This is a Frankenstein minute first. Okay, we're back.
Microphone.
We're back.
Oh, no, it happened quite a few times during the Halloween H2O commentary where my mic kept falling off,
funny.
Which is one reason why I may not put it all together.
Okay, well, that one I don't know.
It's a little clumsy. Plus, we were a little less than lucid.
Yeah, that's true. So then we cut to the bedroom.
Oh, well, I have a few things on this yet.
Excellent.
It does play pretty much as written in the script. One of the first of Valerie Hobbs's not so great moments is, "I was foretold of this, to beware my wedding night." It's a very hokey line. It's very theatrical. And, you know, she does the best that anybody could probably do with it. And it's fine. It fits the tone. It's another thing that I can't see Mae Clark doing very well.
Yeah.
The same timbre.
My theory isn't so fantastical. Maybe this is a different Elizabeth. Because, yeah, that's nothing she would have. That's just not how she would have played
Clark
it.
Is tied up in the broom closet. Elizabeth has taken her place.
I mean,
Henry's so out of it, he doesn't notice the difference.
Like, Mae Clark's role in Frankenstein, as thankless as it may have been, when she is on screen, she's bright, and she's bright in any sense of the word.
Right,
she's intelligent, and she's a bright
presence.
She's so supportive of Henry,
yeah.
and not irrational
she's
about
not
it
irrational,
in any way.
She's not emotional.
She grounds him
in
these scenes. You know, I can picture her saying, you know,
yeah.
I don't know what she said, but that's not what's happening here at all.
No,
now we got this fucking lunatic. She's a calamity howler for crying
exactly.
out loud.
She is exactly.
She's a Cassandra.
She's seeing.
Well, we'll get there. It has started already.
Yes. Then we have Una like shrieking like what she does best, but that's not the kind of reaction you want, I don't think, in this situation.
Shrieking, what did you say? Mini shrieks.
Yeah, he's alive.
Yeah.
I can't imagine even saying this good news, reporting it like that isn't going to make anybody, oh, well, okay, everything's going to be okay now.
She freaks out.
Yeah.
She screams, ah!
Yeah.
And then she says, he's alive, m'lady! And then she just keeps, woo!
It's like, okay. Get her the fuck out of here.
Yeah.
Let's, you know.
Yeah.
Because, okay, if he's alive, this is not helping.
Yeah.
At all.
Exactly. They should show Henry at that point. What the fuck
like,
going
Jesus
on?
Christ.
Will you shut up?
And that's about all I had.
Okay.
Then now we're left with...
Cut to the bedroom.
Yet another set. Another great set, which we're getting more and more towards the, like you said, the Son of Frankenstein, with the arcing walls, with not a lot of detail, but they're...
Shadows.
Yeah, it's that same lighting, that moody.
When I was trying to figure out what's even on the wall, because there's so many shadows just coming through that window, and it's clearly nighttime.
Yep.
I don't want to jump around too much, but she says, and this isn't in the script. She says, "You can go to bed now, Mary." Well, I'm jumping around, but we're here now. Yeah. So you can go to bed now, Mary, which makes me wonder what time or day it is.
That's exactly what I was going to bring up. Is this the same day?
No idea.
But I think not, because of what happens in the next minute.
Okay.
Something she says in the next minute.
Okay. All right. I'll look forward to that next week.
Yeah, because this pretty much ends as she walks over to the bed, right?
Yeah. One thing I wanted to note is Elizabeth has changed from her slinky wedding dress into her slinky nightgown,
yeah.
Yeah. And the bedroom is magnificent. You know, if it is, here's my thing. If it is the same night, it must be getting awfully late.
Yeah.
Because we've organized and
executed a posse.
Yeah. Yes, exactly. Yeah. Not just a posse, but a lynch mob to go with it. So that's interesting, your use of the term posse, because that assumes that the burgomaster has deputized,
I guess
everybody.
I think he kind of has.
Yeah.
At the end of Frankenstein. You go that way and, you know, find him, but he must be found.
Yep.
There he is, the murderer. Perfectly responsible thing for the leader to do.
So when you said Livingston, I thought his name was Richardson. Is it Livingston? The guy at the end of Frankenstein?
Yeah, it's Livingston.
Livingston, I'm sorry. I wrote down Richardson. It looks like him in the mirror.
It looks like him in the mirror, yeah.
At the end of this minute, if you didn't know any better, you might think it was him.
Yeah.
But it's not.
No.
And we'll talk. This will be our hype for next week.
Segue into next week.
Is who is the mysterious figure in the mirror? Not very mysterious.
Not at all.
Do we still have a Patreon going?
I think so.
Yeah, no, it's still going.
We didn't disband it, as far as I know.
I don't know. What are we supposed to talk about?
Nothing.
The Patreon? Just leave it. Okay. Maybe I'll find a way to do it next time.
There we go.
That works better.
Yeah.